After completion of this section, you'll be able to identify all major components and explain their design and function. The boiler is a complicated construction of steel tubes, pipes, and drums. The primary boiler of the D type has an upper and a lower drum connected together with hundreds of tubes and pipes. The upper drum is the steam water drum, and the lower one the water drum. Water is circulating inside the pipes that are arranged as walls. Inside the furnace, the water in the risers is heated by the flames from the oil burners. As the density of water is 30 times the density of steam, the mixture of steam and water will flow to the top drum. The heavier water in the top drum will flow back to the lower drum through the downcomers, outside the furnace walls. The steam-water mixture travels around in the boiler at a velocity of 0.3 to 1 meters per second. In the upper drum, the steam will leave the water saturated steam with a water content of approximately 0.25%. Primary steam is entering the evaporating coil in the secondary steam drum and is condensed as the energy is transferred to the secondary steam system. This steam is heated above boiling temperature and it is passing the superheater in the furnace. Close to the burners, the temperature can reach 2000 degrees centigrade, so it is very important that we always have a sufficient flow of steam through the superheater when we are firing the boiler. The feed water coming from the economizer is always colder than the water in the boiler. It is mixed with the hot water by a long perforated feed pipe inside the upper drum. Approximately 30% of the energy in the fuel oil to the diesel engine is lost in the exhaust gas. To utilize some of this energy loss, we install exhaust gas boilers in the uptake. Exhaust gas dampers control the amount of heat allowed through to the evaporating coils in the boiler. As this boiler is an integrated part of the total steam plant, a set of circulation pumps force the feed water through the exhaust gas boiler when we are firing the boiler. The exhaust gas boiler is equipped with soot blowers to keep it clean and efficient. To minimize the loss of energy in the exhaust gas, several types of air preheaters have been developed. Jungström's rotating air preheater is a common type. Several thousands of steel plates are arranged in a large cylindrical housing. An electrical motor turns the preheater at a rate of 2 to 5 revolutions per minute. The exhaust gas heats about 60% of the steel plates, and at the same time, the air cools the remaining 40%. The air preheater works according to the counterflow principle. Bypass dampers on the air and exhaust side control the flow. Exhaust temperature below 110 degrees centigrade results in the formation of sulfuric acid. The economizer is placed in the exhaust gas uptake below the air preheater. This can be a single unit or several units working together. The feed water pump pushes the feed water through the economizer before it enters the steam water drum. The water temperature can increase to above 230 degrees centigrade. If the economizer temperature gets too high, the feed water will start to evaporate and the steam may reduce the free flow of feed water. To increase the energy content of the steam, and thereby the steam plant thermal efficiency, and dry it completely, the saturated steam passes the superheater before it leaves the boiler. Like the economizer, the superheater can be arranged differently from one type of boiler to another. Usually, the superheater tubes are protected by one or more walls of risers. In this way, the hottest gases pass these risers first, and the combustion temperature is less harmful to the superheater tubes. The steam outlet temperature from the superheater can be well above 500 degrees centigrade. Not all machinery and equipment are operated by superheated steam. We still want to keep the high pressure, and therefore we only want to reduce the temperature. This is done by a de-superheater. A simple and common way of de-superheating is to inject water in the steam flow. Some boilers have a separate steam cooling coil inside the low water drum. De-superheated steam can be used for reciprocating machinery, heating and atomizing steam. The purpose of the deaerator is to be an expansion tank for the condensate from the condenser, as the flow of water to the boiler vary with the load, to remove air and other non-condensable gases from the feed water. Feed water preheater, as it is mixing steam and water. It may be a condenser for several minor steam consumers. The deaerator is placed approximately 10 meters above the feed water pump, and will by that protect the pump from the steam flashing and cavitation. By heating the feed water with steam, the air will boil off and be led to the atmosphere. A level control system will maintain a constant water level in the deaerator. During normal operation of the boiler, there will always be soot and other deposits on the heat surface and in the uptake of the boiler. The soot is mostly carbon from incomplete combustion of fuel oil, but ash and vanadium can also be a problem. Soot blowing has to take place regularly to maintain the thermal efficiency of the boiler. An increase in exhaust temperature after the air preheater of 10 degrees centigrade is a good indication of when to start soot blowing. The soot blower equipment on a large boiler is complicated and needs a lot of maintenance. The number and types of soot blowers depend on the type and the make of the boiler. We have soot blower types like a long stroke retractable blower. This can be electrical or air operated and is usually placed in hot gas areas like the superheater section. The multi-dual nozzle blower. This is placed in lower temperature areas like air preheater and economizer. Typical steam consumption per blower can be 2 kilos per second and air consumption 130 cubic meters per minute. The operation will take approximately 1 minute, but there will only be soot blowing for 20 seconds. An electrical driven centrifugal type of blower supplies combustion air through a short duct to the air preheater. From the air preheater, the ducting follows the boiler front to the oil burners. Even if the blowers have a control damper on the suction side, they may have a 2 to 4 step revolutions per minute controller. This is because we can have a major difference in boiler load during normal operation. On its way to the furnace, the air passes control dampers or air registers before it is mixed thoroughly with the fuel oil. The fuel oil will only be present in the furnace for a fraction of a second. As for a diesel engine, it is therefore very important that the fuel oil is properly atomized and mixed with the combustion air. If the fuel oil is not completely and immediately burning, small particles of oil will form soot and other deposits in the furnace and exhaust uptake. This will reduce the heat transfer, and excessive soot blowing is necessary to maintain the boiler efficiency. To obtain the best possible atomizing, several types of burners have been developed. Pressure atomizing using high pressure oil pumps. Steam or air atomizing using low pressure saturated steam. When there is no steam available for fuel oil heating and atomizing, we use diesel oil to start firing the boiler and later on change to fuel oil. Rotating burners, driven by an electrical motor. Possible reasons for combustion problems can be poor atomizing, check, change, burner tip, too low atomizing steam pressure, too much water in the steam, fuel, oil, too low oil pressure, check pump and filters, wrong fuel oil viscosity, too little combustion air, too low speed on air blower, malfunction of air damper control, deposits on air blower, deposits in the air preheater, air or exhaust side, tuning of air oil ratio controller, deposits on economizer. All boilers shall be provided with at least two safety valves on the steam drums. Solas Chapter 2, 1. If it is possible to close off superheater and economizer sections during firing, and they are still subject to combustion gases, they must have separate safety valves. The size of the safety valve should at least be sufficient to prevent the steam pressure from increasing more than 10% above normal pressure. Even if the oil burners are working at full capacity for 15 minutes and all steam valves are closed, the safety valves must have an arrangement that makes it possible to release the boiler pressure from deck and engine room. On boilers with working pressure up to 20 bar, the safety valve is normally of the spring-loaded type. The tension of the spring can be adjusted. When the steam pressure increases above the spring load, the valve will open and the steam will act on a ring in the valve housing. The valve keeps open until the steam pressure is reduced below normal operating pressure. Another type of safety valve is the full-stroke valve. A small spring-loaded valve is first activated by the increased steam pressure. This valve is a pilot valve for the full-stroke valve, and the steam pressure will push a piston that opens the safety valve. To convert the heat and pressure energy in the steam entering the turbine, the steam passes one or several groups of nozzles. These nozzles can be of the convergent or the convergent-divergent type. In the convergent nozzle, the velocity of steam increases until the velocity of sound at that particular pressure. The pressure drop in the nozzle is called the critical pressure drop. To obtain the total pressure drop, this type of turbine has several wheels with an increasing diameter on the blades towards the outlet side of the turbine. The convergent-divergent type of nozzle, also called the Laval nozzle, has an expansion of the steam volume in the divergent part of the velocity and can be as high as 800 meters per second. Typical turbines of this type are feed water turbines, cargo pump turbines, and turbine-driven generators. This type of turbine is often called the Curtis turbine. The steam velocity is brought down in two steps. From the Laval nozzle, the steam enters the first rotating wheel and leaves this in the opposite direction. Passing through the fixed nozzles, then entering the second rotating wheel, and the steam velocity is now close to zero when it leaves the last blade. The working principle of this turbine is called the impulse type. Because of the high steam velocity, this type of turbine is not very efficient and consequently not used as main propulsion machinery. Turbines can also be categorized as back pressure or vacuum condenser types. Some of the energy in the steam is converted to cinematic energy in the nozzles and enters the turbine rotor blades with a velocity of several hundred meters per second. For each turbine wheel, the steam pressure drops until most of the available energy in the steam is converted to mechanical work. Exhaust steam enters the condenser at low pressure and temperature, and a volume up to 500 times higher than on the inlet side of the turbine. The condensate is pumped by a condensate pump to the deaerator. We have several types of feed water pumps, depending on the size and type of the boiler installation. On a large installation, we normally have two identical steam turbine-driven centrifugal pumps. Each of the pumps has a capacity well above the total boiler capacity. In addition to the two main pumps, we also have an auxiliary pump. This can be of the reciprocating type and used to fill the boiler after inspection and maintenance work.